بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد فقال الله تعالى في كتابه أن الله سبحانه وتعالى says in his book وهل أتاك حديث موسى إذ رأى نارا فقال لأهلهم كثوا إني آنست نارا لعلي آتيكم منها بقبس أو أجد على النار هدى. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in his book, have you not heard the story of Musa alayhi salam, of Moses? What is the story he's telling us here? He tells us that before Musa alayhi salam, before Moses was a messenger, before he was a prophet, he lived in a small town called Al-Midyan. And he got married there, and he had a family, and he had a wife and children there. And he worked there for 8 or 10 years. So he starts his life there. For 8 or 10 years he's working, and he establishes a family. And so after that time is finished, he goes back to wherever he's from, his home city, Misr. He goes back to Egypt, essentially. And he takes his family and he starts to travel. And as he's traveling, remember in his time, when they're traveling, there is no street lights, there are no highways, there are no rest stops, there are no hotels, there are no restaurants. It's just him and his family going through the dark in the nights and going through the desert or nothingness in the day. And as he's going on his journey, it's becoming difficult, it's becoming very tough. And he's looking for some hope, for some guidance, for some light. And all of a sudden, at one point, he tells his family, wait, stop. He says, I think I feel or see something, some light in the distance. There's a fire or something in the distance. And notice in the verse, he didn't tell his family stop. He says, he didn't tell them, I see something. He says, I feel as though there is something there, or I see something or feel something over there. So he tells his family, wait here, and I will go to the light and see what it is. Maybe I can come back with some light, with a torch, with some fire, or with some guidance. Somebody is there who can guide us and help us on our journey. And so Musa alayhi salam goes towards that light. And he goes towards that light, he finds the cave, the valley, and the mountain. And he enters upon it. And what is waiting there for him? Not just physical guidance. There is guidance for him, but it is more spiritual. It is spiritual guidance waiting there for him. It is in fact Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is Allah, it is God who is waiting there for him to speak to him directly. And Allah speaks to Musa alayhi salam directly. And he says, فَاسْتَمِعْ لِمَا يُوحَى. He says, listen carefully as to what is being revealed to you. Musa alayhi salam comes to this place, he just hears a voice. He has no idea what's going on, who this person is, who this voice belongs to, who is speaking to him. So Allah says, فَاسْتَمِعْ لِمَا يُوحَى. Listen to what is about to be revealed to you. And the following is not just a revelation to Musa alayhi salam. It is a revelation to each and every one of us today. And Allah says, قَالَ إِنَّنِي أَنَا اللَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَا. He said, the voice says, it is me, it is Allah. There is no God but Allah. There is no God but me. That is the voice. And the first message for us is, we establish, yes, there is Allah and there is no God but Him. And he goes on, so what? Once we establish this, so what? فَاعْبُدْنِي وَأَقِيمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِي. And he says, so what? So worship me. So worship me. How? How? What is the best form? What is the essence of that worship? And establish the prayer so that you may remember me for your own sake. وَأَقِيمِ الصَّلَاةَ. Establish a salah. Establish the prayer so that you can remember me. Allah chooses Musa alayhi salam, Moses peace be upon him, in this location, in this time, to speak to him directly. And the first command, the first order he gives him is worship me by establishing the prayer. Another chapter of the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says also,
وَاذْكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ مَرْيَمَ إِذٍ تَبَذَتْ مِنْ أَهْلِهَا مَكَانًا شَرْقِيًّا.
And remember the story of Maryam, of Mary, peace be upon her, the mother of Jesus. What happened to her? He says that she went away from her people, from her ahl, from her people in the city, to an isolated area, to get away from the city. And while she's in this area, what happens? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah God sends down Jibreel alayhi salam. He sends down the angel Gabriel, peace be upon him. And she sees a man in the form of a man. And she sees this man and she says, I seek refuge in Allah. I seek refuge in Allah from you. And he tells her, I am just a messenger sent by Allah to give you glad tidings of what? Of a baby that will be born to you. And she says, how can I have a child and no man has ever touched me? How can I have a child? And he says, this is the order of Allah. And so he blows the ruh, he blows the soul into her stomach. It is in, and Isa alayhi salam, Jesus is conceived in her womb. And so she goes through the difficulty of labor, she goes through the difficulty of pains, and she gives birth eventually to the small baby. Now, she goes back to her people. And what happens there? The people know that Mary, Maryam alayhi salam, they know that she is a righteous woman. They know that she is a good woman. They know her family is a good family. And they are shocked to see her come back with a baby without getting married, without a husband, without anything. And they accuse her of what? Of adultery. They say, how can you come and do something like this? We know only good of you. How can you come and do something like this? And the most profound part is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells her that if anybody talks to you today, do not defend yourself. Do not defend yourself. Do not even speak. In fact, take an oath that you are not allowed to speak to anybody this day when you go back to your people. He does not let her defend herself. Why? From the mercy of Allah, he says, I will defend you. I will come and help you. And what does he do? He tells her to point. She points to the baby. So her whole city, the people in her city are come and asking her, accusing her. And all she does is, she doesn't say a word, she points to a baby. فَأَشَارَتْ إِلَيْهِ. She just points to him. And they say, what good is that? The people say, what's the point in going to a baby? What is this baby going to do? What is he going to tell us? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends the mercy and his gift on this baby, who is 2 or 3 days old, however old he is, and he makes him speak. And what's the first thing he says?
قَالَ إِنِّي عَبْدُ اللَّهِ آتَانِيَ الْكِتَابَ وَجَعَلَنِي نَبِيًّا.
He says, I am the slave of Allah, and he has given me a book, and he has made me a messenger.
وَجَعَلَنِي مُبَارَكًا أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُ وَأَوْصَانِي.
And he has made me blessed. He has put blessings in me. Wherever I go in my life, I will bring blessings. I will be a blessed person. And
وَأَوْصَانِي وَأَوْصَانِي بِالصَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ مَا دُمْتُ حَيَّا.
And he has ordered me, the first thing he has ordered me is as-salah. Is the prayer. A small baby, the first thing he has ordered me is to do is what? Establish the prayer and give charity. When? From the time he is born, مَا دُمْتُ حَيَّا. As long as I live, as long as I am alive, establish the prayer. The first order given to the small baby. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in another incident in the Quran,
سبحان الذي أسرى بعبده ليلا من المسجد الحرام من المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد الأقصى الذي باركنا حوله لنريه من آياتنا إنه هو السميع البصير.
And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, praise be to Allah, glory be to Allah, who took his slave Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on a miraculous journey. Where did this journey start? Where did it start? In Mecca. In Masjid al-Haram, which exists today, until today, in Mecca. And where did he take him to? Aywa, al-Masjid al-Aqsa, al-Quds, which is in Palestine today. The Masjid exists today. From Mecca to al-Quds. The first part of the journey is from here to here in one night. In a single night. When he gets to Masjid al-Aqsa in Palestine, he prays there with all the messengers, and the second part of the journey begins. What is that? Al-Mi'raj. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends down Jibreel, the angel Gabriel, peace be upon him, and he ascends with the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam all the way up to the heavens. And know that our sky, our solar systems, our galaxies, everything we see in our sky has not even reached the first heaven yet. And above our galaxies and our system and our existence are seven heavens. Each one on top of it is like a ring in the desert. That's the comparison of it. How grand is the creation of Allah. And so he goes above the seven heavens with the messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, until he reaches a point when Jibreel says, the angel says, this is my limit. I am not allowed to go past this point. And you must go, messenger of Allah, up to this point, beyond this point, by yourself. I don't have the authority, nobody has the authority to go above. Because above everything is what? Is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he says, Allah has called you to go and speak to him directly. And so, the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ascends past that point until he goes and he speaks directly to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He speaks directly to him. And what is this conversation? What does this speech consist of? He says in the hadith, "Thumma furida alayya as-salah." And then it was made mandatory, compulsory upon me, what? As-salah, the prayer. Notice that every single thing in Islam we have today, every rule, every revelation, every verse in the Quran, every act of worship, everything we do, it started from Allah sending His message and decree and revelation from up through the heavens down to this earth. Everything we know today came in this way, revealed from Allah down to this earth, except for one revelation, except for one order, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took the Prophet of Allah up to Him directly, to speak to him, to give him this order, and that was the order of prayer. That was the order of as-salah, to show the importance of this one order. And so what happens next? The messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is given this order of prayer. How many prayers? 50. Next time, inshallah, jazakallah khair, you're gonna answer the question. 50 prayers, okay? 50 prayers to start off with. And he goes down to Musa alayhi salam. He goes down to the heavens, back to earth, and he meets there Musa alayhi salam, Moses. And Moses asks him, what did your Lord decree? And he says, he told me to pray, establish prayer for me and my ummah, the people who follow me, 50 times a day. And Musa alayhi salam says, فَرَجِعْ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكْ فَاسْأَلْهُ التَّخْفِيفِ. He says, go back to your Lord, go back to Allah, and ask Him to reduce it. Because your people will not be able to handle it. He says, I know, I have been a prophet for a long time, I have experience with people. People will not be able to pray 50 times a day. And so the messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam goes back to Allah, and he asks for it to be reduced, and it is reduced to 40 or 45, depending on the hadith. And he goes back to Musa, and the same conversation takes place. And he goes back to Allah, and it is reduced again. And the same conversation takes place. And it is reduced and reduced and reduced until it comes to 5. 5 prayers, which is what we know today. And even then, the messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam goes back to Musa, and he says, Musa says, what did the Lord tell you? He says, 5 prayers a day now. He has reduced it to 5 prayers. And Musa alayhi salam says, still go back and ask him to make it less. Go back and ask him to make it even less than this. And just when he says that, the voice, the command of Allah comes down, and he says, this is my decree, the prayer is 5 times a day. But the reward of it will be 50. The prayer that you have to pray is 5 times, but the reward of those 5 prayers will be as if they have prayed 50 times a day. And so, if we reflect and think about these 3 stories, here is where everything comes together. We think about these 3 examples, these 3 stories, these 3 prophets, that in each one of them, there is a very, very important message for us. That when Allah speaks to His prophets in the Quran and gives orders and things that happen and stories happen, it is not for their benefit only, it is for our benefit. And every single one of these has a very important message for us, every single person sitting here today. And we go to the first story. Who was it about? Which prophet were we talking about? Musa alayhi salam, Moses. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Musa that, O Musa, I have chosen you, I have selected you to speak to me directly without any intervention. The message for us here is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, O Muslim, if you want to speak to me directly with no intervention, then all you have to do is pray. And if you want to speak to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord of the worlds, the one who has created everything, the God of everything, you want to speak to Him, all you have to do is pray. It doesn't have to be in the mosque. Anywhere you are, just stand up and pray, and you come to a direct speech and communication with Allah. And that's what the scholars say, that if you want to speak to Allah, then pray. And if you want Allah to speak to you, read the Quran. Because the Quran is the word of Allah. And the prayer is for you to get your word to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the message in the first story. The second story, who was it about? Isa alayhi salam, Jesus, peace be upon him. The message for Isa there is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He chose this prophet, He chose this baby, and He blessed him with one of the greatest gifts, the greatest miracles we have ever seen. He makes a child a few days old speak these profound words. The beautiful gift and blessing He has sent upon Isa alayhi salam. The message for us is, O Muslim, the most beautiful gift that I have chosen for you, that I have bestowed upon each and single one of you, is what? Is salah, is the prayer. Allah has chosen us and given us this beautiful gift of prayer, just as He gave Isa the gift of speech. In the third example, we talked about the Messenger going up and giving the decree of the prayer, of salah. That was the ascension of the Prophet ﷺ. That was his honor, that he ascended and he got to speak to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly, right? And I cannot say it better than the message, I cannot say it better than Hassan al-Basri, the scholar, this great scholar of Islam. Listen to what he said. He said, As-salatu mi'rajul mu'min. He said, the prayer is the ascension of the believer. The prayer is the ascension of the Muslim. What does that mean? Today, if you want to ascend spiritually, if you want to come to a level spiritually that so many people are lacking in this world, Muslim or not Muslim, if you want to fulfill yourself spiritually, ascend to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you have nothing but the prayer, the salah. That is your way to ascend spiritually. But it does not stop there. Because this spiritual and metaphysical ascension is also physical. This ascension, like Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam ascended to the heavens, it is also a chance for us to ascend in the exact same way. You ask how? We have been praying for a long time, nobody has ever ascended. Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبَّنَا اللَّهُ ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا تَتَنَزَّلُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ أَلَّا تَخَافُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا. The ones who say that Allah is our Lord, is God, we establish that Allah is God, and then they stand firm and they pray and they do what they're supposed to do, that angels would descend upon them. Have we ever seen angels descend upon us? No. What does this verse mean? This verse means that at the time of death, that when you are close to the moments of death, just before your soul is taken away, every single person will have a vision of what? Of angels descending upon them. For what? To take their soul. And this is where the ascension, the physical ascension takes place. And there are many, many examples, physical examples and stories I can give you, that people just before passing away, they have said, that we have seen something and we see something just before the moments they have passed away. Many examples. We go back to the Quran though, because that is what we believe in. And so Allah says, at those moments, you will see the angels of mercy, the ones who have established the prayer, the ones who believed in Allah, you will see them come down and take your soul and then what? Physically ascend with you up to the heavens. And so like that was a physical ascension of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that will also, for each and each Muslim who is righteous, who was pious, to be a physical ascension for them to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to see His place in front of Allah, eventually see Allah and speak to Allah directly, as the Prophet Musa and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did as well. And so this is the message for us in each one of these three stories. But the last one, in that last example of Isra wal Mi'raj, the ascension of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there's a very important question that I've thought about many times, and even the ulama, the scholars have thought about. They say, look, the prayer that was established, or the instructions that were given, were how many? 50 prayers, right? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah knows that eventually it's going to be 5 prayers, right? So why did He make it 50? And then why did He make the messenger go back and reduce it to 40, or 45, and 30, and 25, and 15, and 5? Why did we have to go through all this? When Allah knows it's going to be 5, He knows what's going to happen, why didn't He just say, the prayers are 5, end of story? Why did He go through all of this whole procedure, this whole process? Why can't He just say it's 5 prayers and that's what's meant for us? The ulama said there are 2 great benefits, there are 2 important lessons to learn. The first thing is Allah wants to show us the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That prayer is not a burden for you, it's a mercy for you. Why? Because He's telling us that if you just pray 5 times a day, you are getting the reward of 50 times. Is not something that is extremely merciful, extremely rahmah, the mercy of Allah, that He's making us do 5 prayers, but He is giving us the reward of 50 prayers. And that was the first reason why this was revealed in this way. What's the second thing? The second thing the ulama, the scholars say, is to show us essentially the purpose of our existence, the purpose of our lives. Imagine if we have 50 prayers a day. That means every 30 or something minutes, we would be praying. Every 25-20 minutes, we'd be making wudu, preparing for prayer. And every 25 to 30 minutes, we'd be standing in prayer. The whole day, 24 hours a day. Allah is telling us, what He tells us in the Quran, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنْسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, that we have not created you except to worship Allah. He's telling us that worship, and the essence of worship is prayer, that is the purpose essentially in life. He's not saying just sit and pray all day, no. No, but He's saying that is the importance of the prayer. That is the importance of connecting yourself and worshiping Allah. That is how important it is. And to show us essentially that is one of the purposes of our lives. And that's why we come and we say that the importance of life, the importance of prayer in our life, and that's why when we meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment, the first thing every single one of us, each and every single one of us will be asked about on the Day of Judgment is what? Is our prayer. The first thing Allah will ask us is not how did you spend your time, how did you spend your money, what did you do this day, what did you do that day, how many children did you have, you know, who were your friends. The first thing He will ask you is what? Is how was your prayer? Did you establish the prayer or not? And if that is successful, if you have passed that, if you've established that, then the rest of your deeds, the rest of your actions will fall into place and be accepted, and everything will be easy. And if that is not, then the rest of your deeds and actions will also be in great difficulty. You will be at loss. Why is it that the first thing we ask about is our prayer? I have a question. If I ask you today, what is Islam? What is the meaning of Islam? It's a religion, it's our religion, yeah, but what does it mean? Islam means submission. What's the first pillar of Islam? Everything revolves around this. Ash-shahada. To say that, we believe that there's only one God. What is that? That is our submission through our tongue. That is our submission in our heart to believe this, right? The submission of the heart is the shahada. That is Islam. Is that complete? Is it complete with that? Is that enough? No. What is the second pillar of Islam?
The second pillar of Islam is as-salah, is the prayer. What is the prayer? Just as believing is a submission of the heart, believing in God submits your heart, prayer is the physical submission in Islam. So if you have one or the other, it is incomplete. That's why you must have both. You must have the spiritual belief that Allah exists and He is the one God, followed by the physical submission, which is the prayer. And you put those two together and you have the basis of Islam, you have the core of Islam. And that's why it's the first thing we'll be asked on the Day of Judgment, because that is the core of everything. Everything revolves around that. And before we finish, know that the prayer is not the same. There is not one prayer for everybody. Or there is not everybody who is praying the same prayer. What do I mean? Ibn Qayyim says that there are five levels of as-salah. There are five levels of what? Of prayer. And as we think about these and hear these, think about yourself and try to reflect where you fall in these five levels. He says the lowest level of prayer, of salah, are the ones who pray not for Allah, for other reasons. Because everybody else is praying, to be seen by people, because somebody has forced you to pray, just like that, out of laziness, pray however you want to pray. Essentially, he's saying this level of prayer is the prayer of the munafiqun, the hypocrites. The one who pray on the outside, but they don't really believe in the inside. And this is very common in the early days in Islam. Many people, even today, the outside and insides do not match. That is hypocrisy. He says this is the lowest level of prayer. That people pray even though with nothing inside. They just pray like that. He says these people will, Allah has every right to hold them accountable and punish them because of their hypocrisy. Because they have not come forth with which what is obligatory. Notice he doesn't even talk about the people who don't pray. Right? We have people also, the level below that is what? The people who would not even establish the prayer. And if you go a level below that, the people who don't establish prayer, many times you ask, you know, why don't you pray? And the three most common answers are, if they're Muslim, of course, the three most common answers are, the first one that, from experience and hearing people say that we don't pray because of time. We don't have enough time. Allah addresses this in the Quran. He says, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ كَانَتْ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ كِتَابًا مَوْقُوتًا. He says that the prayer is just, it's just at fixed times, short times throughout the day, five times. If you actually think about it, you can pray each prayer in about 5 minutes. 5 times 5 is 25. In 25 minutes, you can pray 25 minutes a day. You have 24 hours a day. So you have no excuse of time, because it's very simple to base your time, your life around prayer, because it's 5 minutes for each prayer, essentially. The second most common excuse is what? What is heard? Why can't we pray? People say that I'm just lazy. I just don't feel like praying sometimes. You know, I'm lazy. What's the answer to this? Allah addresses this in the Quran. He says, وَاسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ. He says, if you're suffering from something and you have a problem, an issue, you're lazy, something, you have a problem, something else happens, how do you fix that problem? He says, seek refuge in two things. Number one, patience. Push yourself and be patient. Number two, prayer. The answer to your laziness is prayer. That's the way to get rid of that laziness, is get up and start praying, and that laziness will go away. That is the answer to your prayer. And that's the second excuse. The third excuse people make is what? They say that I don't feel spiritual enough. I don't feel like I can pray. I don't feel like at the level I can pray. You know, maybe sometime when it comes and I get spirituality, I'll start praying. And what's the answer to this? Allah says, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنكَرِ. He says that if you want spirituality, the only way, the contradiction is, if you want spirituality and you want to stay away from the evil things and sin, what's the answer? The answer again is prayer in itself. That you can't just wait magically and snap your fingers and one day something will come inside you and start to pray. In fact, you start to pray and that spirituality will come to you and that will build inside of you. You have to make the first step and just pray. So all three excuses are addressed in the Quran, subhanAllah. The most common excuses. We go back to the levels of prayer before we finish. The last level, the second level of prayer above that last level we talked about was what? He said that level is the people who pray only from the outside and not on the inside. Essentially, they pray out of habit or ritual. And wallahi, if you go today and see the state of the Muslims today, most, if not a lot of Muslims today in many different countries, the only reason they pray is because out of habit, or because their parents told them, or because they have to pray. One of the kids I teach a Saturday class sometimes in the mosque. One of the kids, the young kids, maybe 13 or 14 years old, he tells me, he were talking about parents, you know, obeying your parents. And he says, whenever I disobey my father, do something wrong, he tells me, go and pray. Your punishment is you have to go and pray. And I said, and that actually broke my heart. I said, subhanAllah, this is the greatest gift Allah has given us to our families, to the Muslims, to the children, and they make it a punishment. So this is a level of prayer, we make it something that is just ritualistic. It's a ritual, it's a punishment, it's a burden. Go and you have to pray, just pray because everybody's praying. Pray because you have to pray. Or they just do it from the outside. And he says, these people, the people who pray like this, Allah will question them on the Day of Judgment, will hold them accountable, will ask them, why did you not pray properly? Why did you not focus and learn about your religion? They will be held accountable. He says, the level above this, the people who pray, are who? The people who pray and they have a good intention. They want to pray for the sake of Allah. But they are so distracted by their thoughts and their life and what's happening in their day, here and there, that they can't focus in their prayer properly. So their prayer essentially is two things. Half of it is worship of God, and half of it is jihad, is struggle. So half of it is worshiping Allah, the second half is struggling with themselves to try to focus in prayer. And he says, these people, Allah will no doubt accept their prayer. Why? He will accept their prayer and give them good because they are trying. They are struggling, they are trying for good, they are focusing and they are making jihad in themselves, Allah will accept their prayer. But there's a level above that. He says the fourth level, or the second highest level of prayer, is that the people who pray with absolute submission, that they are focused inside spiritually, they have good intentions, and they're outside also, they're focused properly. They have a perfect prayer, a prayer that is in perfection. And he says, these people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them a great reward because they have come from the obligation with perfection. But he says, there is a level even higher than this. There is a level even higher than this level. What is that level? What can be higher than this level? He says, the highest level of prayer are the ones who pray as if they see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in front of them. They pray, they have the state of ihsan. This in Islam is called al-ihsan. It is the highest state of worship, that you worship and pray as if you see Allah in front of you. That they actually not just pray because they're ordered to, they find pleasure in their prayer. They find this pleasure and delight in their heart in their prayer. And that is the highest level of prayer. And this in Islam, this in prayer is called al-khushur. And we will end with this concept of khushur and how to take ourselves to this last level that we can find pleasure and benefit in our prayer. Two things before we end. Number one, what does this word mean, al-khushur? Number two, how can we achieve it? Very briefly, very simply. Al-khushur in Islam, in prayer, it consists of three things. It means three things. The first thing is submission, which leads to the second thing, which is to be humble. To humble yourself in front of Allah. And the third thing is to find tranquility. So if you have these three things in your prayer, submission, humbleness, and tranquility, then you have this concept called khushu', and you have this highest level of spirituality, this high level of khushu' in your prayer, where can you achieve this pleasure and this connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Basically, that's the definition. But how do we achieve this realistically? What does this mean? How do we achieve this? I'll give you an example. Say, for example, wherever you guys work, everybody has a job, they work somebody, or they work somewhere before, in a company, or you have your own company. For example, you work in your company, and you get a call today, and somebody says, look, the CEO of this company wants to meet with you tomorrow. and your future, the future of your survival or success in this company depends on that meeting. So come in tomorrow at 9 o'clock in the morning and have a meeting with the CEO face to face. He wants to meet you in person. So you say, okay, how would you approach this meeting? The first thing you're gonna do is mark it down, 9 o'clock a.m. You're gonna try to get there on time? No. You're gonna try to get there early at 8:45 or 8:30 so you can prepare. How are you gonna prepare for this meeting? Number one, physically. You're gonna wear the best clothes you have to wear. You're gonna smell nice, you're gonna groom yourself, you're gonna look nice. You're gonna come with a smile on your face, you're gonna come with enthusiasm. Number two, inside, how are you gonna prepare internally? How? You're gonna think of what you're gonna say. What questions will he ask me? What answers can I give him? You're gonna think, make sure your heart is present in that meeting. Make sure you're there dedicated 100%, right? This is how you prepare for that meeting. Similarly, your prayer or your salah with Allah is an invitation by Allah to meet Him 5 times a day, every single day. And what is more important? Think of this question and reflect and answer it honestly. Do we prepare better? Would we prepare better for that meeting with the CEO or the meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? No doubt, if we're honest, and I'll be the first one to say, I put more focus and preparation into the meeting with the CEO. But if we think of it the other way, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah, Lord of the world, is inviting us every day to meet with Him, we put the same preparation into those prayers. Briefly, physically, first of all, when you make your wudu, when you make your purification, have an intention and a focus in that. You do it with perfection. Wear your best clothes to the mosque when you go to pray or at home. Don't pray in just whatever you would go in. Wear your best clothes, smell nice, groom yourself, make yourself beautiful for that prayer. Internally, before you pray for a few moments, sit down, reflect on yourself. That is the point of the adhan. Why do we make adhan and wait 5 or 10 minutes? What's the point of that? To prepare yourself spiritually, physically, mentally for the prayer. You're preparing yourself, right? And last but not least, that when you go with that meeting with the CEO, everything you say to him, you know what it means and you know what you're gonna say. Similarly, everything you say in the prayer, you have to know what it means. And there's no excuse for this. People say, we don't know Arabic. Okay, you don't know Arabic. But the prayer, 80%, 90% of the prayer is the same words every single day, 5 times a day. And for you to understand those words in any language, whatever language you speak in, it will take you 1 or 2 hours. That's it. And you understand 90% of your prayer. The other 10% is the verses of the Quran you read. Take a small verse every day if you don't understand it. Read it. Don't just read it. Reflect upon it and say, this is the verse I will read today, and internalize it. And when you have all of these things, the physical preparation, the spiritual preparation, the mental preparation, then your prayer becomes not a burden, but pleasure. Your prayer becomes something you look forward to, and you find pleasure in it, and it makes it easier to establish the prayer. I'll end with one example, a brief story of one of the most beautiful examples I found of this khushu, of this pleasure, of this connection in prayer. During the time of the Prophet ﷺ, the fourth year of Hijrah, the fourth year after migration, the Prophet was in Medina. And this was a very volatile time, a time where Islam was being attacked and a time where there were many enemies of Islam. And the Prophet ﷺ learned at this time that there were some tribes around Arabia who were getting ready to attack the Muslims, coming to Medina and attack the Muslims. So he takes with him a group of 400 Muslims, and he says, we will go out to meet them and attack them before they even come to us, to surprise them. So he takes his group of 400 Muslims to meet the army, the enemies. And when they meet at the meeting point, the Muslims stop, and it is time for prayer, time for Asr prayer. And so they stop what they're doing, and in times of war and fear, there's a special kind of prayer. It's called the prayer of fear. That we change our prayer in that time because of the situation. So how did they pray? How they prayed was that the Muslims got up to pray, half of them, and they prayed with the Prophet. So half the army is praying, and the second half is guarding the army, the Muslims, the ones who are praying, to make sure the enemies don't come. So 200 are praying, the other 200 are in the back on guard. And then the first 200 pray half the prayer, and then they go to guard, and the second half come and pray. So they take turns to pray. And what happens is this way, the group is praying and a group is guarding, and a group is praying and a group is guarding. So this is how they prayed the Asr prayer. When the enemies of Islam, they saw this prayer and how it was being done with discipline, with strength, with honor, they were intimidated and they decided to back off. So they didn't fight, there was no battle, and they just backed off from the Muslims. And so the Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the messenger and the Muslim army, they say, okay, it is done, there's no reason to fight, let's go back to Al-Madinah. So they start traveling back to Medina. On their way back, they make camp at a certain area, a specific area. And there they say, the messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, that while the Muslims sleep tonight, we need two people to stand guard amongst us, to make sure, like night guards, like security guards at night, making sure nobody comes in case the enemies come back to us. So two people stood up, one person by the name of Ammar bin Yasir, the second person by the name of Abbad bin Bishr. Ammar and Abbad, and they were very close. They were brothers in Islam, not maternal, but in Islam. So they said, we will guard the Muslims tonight. And so they take turns. So Abbad bin Bishr tells his friend, his brother Ammar, he says, you look tired, so why don't you sleep the first half of the night, and I will guard the Muslims, and you do the second half, and I will sleep the second half of the night. So Abbad bin Bishr, he starts, and he guards the first half of the night. And everybody has gone to sleep now. So he stands in the night, in the darkness, and he starts to guard. After some time, he says, let me use this time to pray. I'm going to use this time to pray to Allah and keep an eye on anything that's happening. So he finds a moment of tranquility, of peace. There's nobody, everybody's sleeping. And he wakes up and he stands up and he starts to pray. He gets in prayer and he recites Surah Al-Kahf, the Surah of the Cave, a beautiful, beautiful Surah, chapter in the Quran. And he starts reciting that verse. And all of a sudden, he's reciting in his prayer, one of the enemies, a lone enemy, he comes from over the valley, and he sees this man is praying, who is supposed to be guarding. And so he takes out his bow and arrow, and he shoots him with the arrow. The arrow comes in. This is an authentic narration narrated in the books of Hadith by authentic chain. The arrow comes to this Abbad bin Bishr, who is praying. It pierces his body, and he starts to bleed. What does he do? He continues praying. So the enemy comes back again. We're in his spot. He takes another arrow and he shoots a second arrow. The second arrow comes through and hits him again in his body, pierces his body. Abbad bin Bishr does not move. He continues to pray. The enemy comes a third time, takes a third arrow and shoots that third arrow. It enters his body for the third time, pierces him, and he's bleeding now. The third piercing, the third arrow has hit him in his body. He quickly finishes his prayer. He does not cut it off. He finishes his prayer and he wakes up. In the end of the prayer, he wakes up his companion, his friend, Ammar, and he signals to him this enemy. And Ammar gets up, goes, runs, and chases him away. The enemy runs away. When Ammar, he sees his brother here, Abbad, he sees his situation. He is pierced by an arrow three times in his body. He is injured. He is bleeding. He says, what happened? Abbad tells him, he says, why? Why when that first arrow hit you, why did he not stop and just tell me somebody's here and just cut your prayer off? And Abbad responds beautifully. He says, by Allah, I was in a moment of spiritual connection, of tranquility, of khushu with Allah. And at that moment, death would have been more beloved to me than to cut off my prayer. I would rather have died than to stop my prayer. And the only reason I stopped my prayer was that the Messenger of Allah gave me a responsibility to guard the Muslims, and I was scared. And if I did not have that responsibility, لَقَطْعُ نَفْسِي أَحَبُّ إِلَيَّ مِنْ فَتْحِ الصَّلَاةِ, that cutting off my life would be more beloved to me than cutting off my prayer. Why? Because he had this spiritual connection. He reached the height, the essence of prayer. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those who establish prayer and to make us amongst those who find pleasure and blessings in our prayer. وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين والحمد لله رب العالمين. If anybody has any questions, you're more than welcome to ask. جزاك الله خيرا.